convene the regular meeting of City Council, July 27th, and ask for a roll call.
Jacobson? Fanouken?
Here.
Markort?
Here.
Snow?
Here.
Noriko?
Here.
Baker?
Here.
O'Leary?
Here.
Ray?
Here.
Eight present?
Thank you. In recognition, before we do the pledge this evening, I'd like to acknowledge, in recognition of service given and acknowledging the comradeship that we share. Before reciting the Pledge of Allegiance this evening, I ask you to stand and join with me in a moment of reflection in recognition and support of all affected by a recent tragedy in the DeKalb Police Department staff. Please stand for a moment of recognition and let us assume an attitude of reflection. Thank you for that participation. I will be ordering flags on city buildings lowered to half staff through Monday, August 3rd, in recognition of a fallen comrade. I'll ask Officer Lickle to come forward and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance this evening.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have before us the agenda this evening. I'd entertain any additions or deletions to the agenda. Hearing none, I'll ask for a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
It's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Roll call.
Fanouken?
Yes.
Markort?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
8-aye.
Motion carried. Thank you. Our first item this evening, we have special items, introduction of city management interns. I'll turn to Lauren Stott.
Thank you, Mayor. Before I introduce Emily and Chris this evening, I want to thank the council for being so supportive of the NIU MPA internship program. For a number of years, it's been very successful. We've had interns who have served in the city manager's office as well as other city departments. And Chris and Emily, who have only been here a little over a month, have already been contributing to a number of projects. They've helped us with the city's new website. They've helped with items related to the strategic plan meetings. So we are so grateful at the staff level to have their help and assistance. First here I have Chris Jackson. Chris is from Naperville, but he has lived for the past 4 years in DeKalb while he attended NIU as an undergrad. He received his Bachelor of Science in Political Science and Community Leadership and Civic Engagement from NIU. He also received a minor in Business Administration and a certificate in Social Entrepreneurship. He has interned with FTI Consulting in Washington, D.C., the Egyptian Theater here in DeKalb, and with Career Services at NIU. Chris will be attending NIU in the fall, where he will obtain his Master's of Public Administration degree with a specialization in fiscal administration. Emily Tips is originally from Woodstock, but she also has recently moved to DeKalb. Emily received her associate's degree in science from McHenry County College in Crystal Lake and her bachelor's of science from the University of Central Missouri, where she majored in sociology and political science. Emily has interned with State Representative Jack Franks in Illinois and with the city of Warrensburg in Missouri. Emily will be attending Northern Illinois University this fall, where she will also obtain her Master's of Public Administration, but her focus will be in local government management.
Thank you, Lauren, for those introductions. I do have a proclamation this evening, Bicycle Safety Week, July 27th through August 2nd. Whereas the bicycle is an economical, healthy, and environmentally sound form of transportation for those who ride by choice or by economic or other necessity. And whereas the bicycle is also an excellent tool for exercise, recreation, and enjoyment of DeKalb's scenic beauty. And whereas most bike riders and motorists receive little formal education on the laws and safety techniques governing roadway interactions between motor vehicles and bicycles. And whereas increased knowledge of such interactions will improve safety for both bike riders and motorists. And whereas the League of Illinois Bicyclists is conducting a Mayor's Bicycle Safety Challenge in which Illinois towns encourage residents to learn relevant safety techniques and laws through interactive quizzes at www.bikesafetyquiz.com for adult bicyclists, child bicyclists, and motorists. And therefore, I, John Ray, Mayor of DeKalb, do hereby proclaim July 27th through August 2nd as Bicycle Safety Week in DeKalb. And I urge all residents to join me in taking the quizzes at www.bikesafetyquiz.com. The City of DeKalb will also be partnering with Aspen Leaf Frozen Yogurt for this event. The city appreciates Aspen Leaf's generosity in contributing to the success of this week. Citizens who take the bike safety quiz can print off their bike safety quiz certificate and bring it into Aspen Leaf to receive a 15% discount. The certificates will be accepted the entire week of Bike Safety Week, July 27th through August 2nd. And I appreciate that participation by Aspen Leaf this week. Is there a representative here from either bike safety group?
Thank you very much.
Okay, next we have before us the Yards of Distinction Award. And I'd like to ask if you're present this evening, please come forward and be recognized. Jerry and Lisa Gorchels. The Gorchels reside at 804 North 9th Street, and this is in recognition of your dedication to neighborhood beautification. Congratulations. Donna Waldvogel and Francine St. Clair. And they reside at 1415 Cambria Drive, and this is in recognition of their dedication to neighborhood beautification. Alan and Deborah Brew.
Thank you.
They reside at 2575 Greenwood Acres in recognition of your dedication to neighborhood beautification, Debbie. We have Michael and Elaine Bennett. Michael and Elaine reside at 1423 Margaret Lane in recognition of their dedication to neighborhood beautification. Congratulations. Yes. Thank you. Thomas and Bernadette Reinberg. I don't see them present this evening. They're at 107 West Royal, and in recognition of their dedication to neighborhood beautification. These residences have been nominated to our Enhancement Commission and recognized in this neighborhood beautification Yards of Distinction program for June of 2015. And Brad, help me recall, how often do the Yards of Distinction be recognized?
3 months during the summer, and then we've actually, the last year, also done Yards of Distinction or Lights of Distinction at the holiday time.
Okay, so every 3 months?
Once a month for June, July, and August.
Once a month, June, July, and August, and then Lights of Distinction
in December.
Thank you. Okay, and thank you, citizens, for your contribution to your neighborhoods in the community. Moving on, we have the Outstanding Achievement in Popular Annual Financial Reporting, the PAFR Award. I'll turn to City Manager Gora.
Thank you very much, Mayor. I'd like our Finance Director, Kathy Haley, to say a few words as far as the significance of this award.
I just want to say that this was an amazingly collaborative effort between the City Manager's Office and the Finance Department. I'm very proud of this document. I think a special thank you goes out to Lauren Stott and Jared Haint. I don't know if Jared's here. They both put quite a bit of effort into this final document. To receive the award on the first year, I think it is an amazing accomplishment. And it's something we should be very proud of. We do have copies of the PAFR down in the lobby for anyone who'd like to take one.
Okay. And I should, as a matter of introduction to the PAFR, last week the City of DeKalb staff learned of another award it has received for excellence in financial reporting. The Government Finance Officers Association of the United States and Canada has given an award for outstanding achievement in popular annual financial reporting to the City of DeKalb for its first popular annual financial report for fiscal year ended June 30th, 2014. The award for outstanding achievement in popular annual financial reporting is a prestigious national award recognizing conformance with the highest standards for preparation of state and local government popular reports. In order to receive an award for outstanding achievement in popular annual financial reporting, a government unit must publish a popular annual financial report whose contents conform to program standards of creativity, presentation, understandability, and reader appeal. This PAFR is the first report of its kind to be produced by the City of DeKalb. It was created to help the community better understand the city's fiscal condition. The PAFR includes information about the city's budget, assets and liabilities, sales tax, property tax, and tax levy. The creation of the PAFR was a joint effort from the Finance Department and the City Manager's Office, and these departments are pleased to present the award to City Council. The PAFR is available on the city's website, and as Kathy, Director Haley has indicated, is downstairs at the Finance Department service counter. So thank you to staff for those contributions to understandability of the financial conditions in our community. So thank you to all. Okay, I do have one citizen registered to speak this evening, Kay Shelton.
Well, over the years, I've had to follow animals and angry people, fantastic awards. This time, I got something that's going to blow your mind. My name is Kay Shelton, and I'm here tonight as the president of the Lincoln Highway Association. We have over 1,000 members from 8 countries. On October 31st, 1913, the Lincoln Highway Association dedicated the route of the Lincoln Highway to the memory of President Abraham Lincoln and to the American people. The Lincoln Memorial Highway is unofficially the world's largest memorial to Abraham Lincoln, but is still underutilized, although there is a growing interest in the Lincoln Highway. If you've seen the new Acura commercial with the two guys driving around on hairpin turns across a bridge, that's the Lincoln Highway near Lake Tahoe. I just drove on that 2.5 weeks ago. It's fantastic. I had to follow the speed limit, so I'm jealous of those two guys in that commercial. The Lincoln Highway goes through some of the most spectacular scenery in the United States. You can get to Lake Tahoe from here. Just get on the road, drive west, and you'll get there. The Lincoln Highway should grow to become at least one-third as traveled as Route 66 by tourists. We do have plans to make that happen and to bring greater recognition of the Lincoln Highway and its history as a memorial to Abraham Lincoln. In DeKalb, there's no Main Street. If you ever want to mess with somebody with their GPS, have them find Main Street in DeKalb. Can't do it. In DeKalb, this was the first city in the United States to rename its Main Street as the Lincoln Highway. It seems fitting that the first announcement outside the Lincoln Highway Association about a new plan be made in DeKalb. Through presidential decree, President Obama named the Pullman neighborhood as a national monument, and just a couple of weeks ago, he named several other places in California, Nevada, Texas as national monuments. Following the designation of the Pullman neighborhood as a national monument, the Lincoln Highway is also worthy of a similar designation as a national monument. Being a memorial to the Abraham Lincoln was one of its original purposes. There's already hundreds of statues, historical places, and even businesses named for Lincoln along the Lincoln Highway. The Lincoln Highway was one of two key components in the creation of the interstate highway system, which is something that affects every one of us in the United States. The Lincoln Highway Association now has an online petition to ask for a presidential decree recognizing the Lincoln Highway as a national monument. Over 30 years of research on the history of the Lincoln Highway is already done, the routes already mapped, and hundreds of places of interest along the Lincoln Highway from Times Square, New York City, to the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco are already identified, both past and present, 100% done by volunteers. Please go online to change.org, search for Lincoln Highway, and electronically sign the petition asking that the Lincoln Highway be recognized as a national monument. As seen with the Pullman neighborhood in Chicago becoming a national monument, the designation does not change private property ownership, but it has the potential to increase tourism exponentially. Let me repeat that. Private property ownership does not get changed, but it has the potential to increase tourism exponentially. And Abraham Lincoln is certainly worthy of the world's largest monument. We do need thousands of people to sign the petition electronically, and we have people in 14 states who can sign, plus anybody else who's interested. And those thousands of people should tell their friends and families about it as soon as possible. Once there's sufficient support, we have a plan to send to Washington, D.C. to ask that the Lincoln Highway be recognized as a national monument. The clerk has the petition URLs, and I have copies if anybody wants them. It also has our copy of our map, too. And thank you.
Kate, thank you for the presentation this evening. Anyone else wishing to address the council at this time? Seeing none, we'll move on to consent agenda. I'd like to remove item F4 and deal with that as a separate item under items for separate action, resolution 2015-91. We'll have some clarification on that resolution. Kate, you had a correction to minutes?
Yes, the minutes of the city council meeting of June 22nd. G13, paragraph 4, under motion, the word in the minutes as presented was advocated. It should be abdicated, A-B-D-I-C-A-T-E-D.
Okay, that, and that's a correction to the regular minutes?
Yes.
Of June 22nd meeting. Okay, with that, I would entertain a motion to approve consent agenda as amended.
So moved.
It's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Alderperson O'Leary, and it was moved by Alderman Snow. Roll call.
Markort?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Fanouken?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Eight eye?
Motion carried. Moving to resolution 2015-91, authorizing a preliminary engineering services agreement for motor fuel tax with Infrastructure Management Services Incorporated in the amount of $35,000 to evaluate the payment on city streets. I would ask for a motion to approve the resolution.
So moved.
It's been moved by Alderman Snow. Is there a second?
No, second.
Seconded by Alderperson Noriko. I'll entertain discussion, and I've asked City Engineer Laskowski to clarify the intent of this evaluation of pavement on city streets. John?
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. The purpose of a pavement index study is to understand where the city should be directing its limited financial resources throughout the road network in order to best get the best return on its investment. So this is kind of a continuation of the existing study. The pavement index currently looks at both the surface and subsurface of the roadways. These two components then combine to give you a single index number. And I get excited when I talk about pavement. And so I was digging through some of the history of our previous pavement indexing studies. And currently we're using IMS, which is a company that goes out and evaluates the streets with its equipment using lasers and then hammers when it's doing the subsurface. I was across the street at the annex today, just looking for some other materials, and I found our pavement index study from 2006. And so this binder contains just the roads throughout town, A through F. And this study was done manually. So two engineers or an engineer would drive every single street segment in town and then fill out one of the forms in here and evaluate the surface of the road. And that's great, but it doesn't necessarily get to the subsurface, which really tells you the condition of the roads. But I did want to bring this up and show it to you just so you can see kind of the criteria that the engineers would use when they're looking at it. So when I say subsurface test, you can kind of see what they looked at before and now what the computer is looking. So I'm just going to set this up on the desk and you can pass it down.
Thank you.
And so one of the reasons I'm here is to kind of explain exactly where, why we're having the test again in 2015. And so there's a 11 by 17 sheet on your dais that looks like this. And what it shows is in 2012, the TIF streets, we did an evaluation of both the surface and the base. And then on the non-TIF streets, we just evaluated the surface. And the reason for that was because we didn't have the funds at the time to get the base test done. So you're probably wondering, you may have been wondering, you know, why am I coming and asking for all this money in 2015 to do this study again if we just did the base then for the non-TIF streets in 2014? Well, the reason is because we want to get a comprehensive overview of the, both components of the subsurface and the surface of all the streets throughout the city. So this year in 2015, fiscal year 2016, we have $35,000 budgeted throughout town to do the surface. And then once, after that, every 3 years from that point on, we'll be also doing the evaluation of the surface throughout, and the base will be taking place every 6 years after that. So alternating, every 6 years we'll have both tests done, the surface and the base. And again, this test is simply so we can get a very good idea of what's happening on the road network throughout town and allocate our resources appropriately.
Very good. Any questions of John? Alderperson.
Why would you have to do the base as often as every 6 years? Because don't streets last longer than that?
They do. They deteriorate. You want to catch those streets when they start to deteriorate. So we can see that the surface is deteriorating rapidly, and it has a lot more impact. So every 6 years, you want to keep an idea on how the water is getting into the base and seeing it deteriorate. Because once the water gets to the base, it's going to deteriorate really rapidly. So you want to catch it before it gets to the point of you're completely reconstructing the street. So if you notice a slight drop in the condition of the base, that might be an indication that you want to put an overlay or do some crack filling or some form of preventive maintenance on that roadway in order to prevent the base from deteriorating to the point where you have to reconstruct it. So it's kind of a indication that it's a preventive maintenance type item.
And then also, the study that's already been done, that, if I understand correctly, was just the surface. The study that you came and did the Rice Krispies for us.
that study is both components. So two components make an index number. Those index numbers that I presented that outlined a number associated with every street segment, that was the combination of two parts of this test. Mm-hmm. So the reason we did the base in 2014 on the non-TIF streets because it wasn't evaluated in the past. So now we have that full picture as of 2015, so the numbers I have right now are comparing apples to apples.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Are there other questions of the city engineer? Seeing none, I'll ask for a roll call then on the motion.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Finucane?
Yes.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Adye?
Thank you. Motion carried. Moving to ratification of Ordinance 2015-27, adopting the annual budget for fiscal year beginning July 1, 2015. And ending June 30th, 2016 in the city of DeKalb in the amount of $83,043,898. Is there a motion?
So moved.
It's been moved by Alderman Finucane. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Alderman Marquardt. Discussion, I'll ask for City Attorney Frieders.
In reviewing the meeting proceedings from that evening, there was an extensive discussion regarding the budget. The discussion started with the mayor and went to staff and then proceeded to the public and an extensive discussion among council. And there was a vote that ultimately occurred as a roll call vote that successfully passed the budget. However, upon further review, we were concerned about the presence or absence of a motion that effectively made that vote count. So what we brought back before you tonight is an action that would ratify the approval of the budget and eliminate any doubt regarding its adoption. Also, as a component of that, it would ratify the actions taken in reliance on that budget from the start of the fiscal year to date.
Thank you. And I'll apologize to council. My normal procedure is to ask for a motion and a second before we move to discussion. I think in Director Haley's enthusiasm at the podium. We moved directly into discussion, and at the point we came to the vote, I neglected to realize I hadn't requested a motion on the floor, so I do apologize. I'll ask for a roll call at this point.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Finucane?
Yes.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Adye?
Thank you. Motion carried. Ratification of approval of Resolution 2015-70, authorizing an agreement with Preservation of the Egyptian Theater for the purpose of financing facility improvements to the Egyptian Theater with tax increment financing funds not to exceed $330,000 beginning July 1, 2015 through June 30th, 2016. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Alderman Snow. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Alderman Marquardt.
Mayor, the only note we would have for this is that during the course of the meeting at which this was considered, there was an amendment to the motion regarding the timing at which payments would be made. And what we've proposed here incorporates that change to the agreement.
Excellent. Thank you for that attention. Is there a discussion? Seeing none, I'll ask for a roll call.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
No.
Jacobson?
No.
Finucane?
Yes.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
6-I?
Motion carried. Ordinance 2015-33, approving the preliminary and final plat of Unit 4, Lot 12 of Park 88, and the final plat for Unit 4, Lot 12 of Park 88, located on the north side of Fairview Drive, west of Peace Road, and south of Macomb Drive. Is there a motion?
So moved.
It's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion?
I would turn this item over to Community Development Director Ellen DeVito to summarize.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. This item's been before us before as a preliminary when you discussed the incentives that had been requested. I want to point out one variance I was asked about before the meeting began, and that is in regards to the square footage of the distribution center. When the request originally came to us, it was 987,500 square feet. The notice went out at 987. We actually have seen the first preliminary site plan, which listed 97,120. Until the final building plans come in, we will not know the exact number. So there has been a range of square footage, and it's because they're still doing the final design work on the project. So in terms of background, as you saw in the attached plan commission packet, we took a two-phased approach to this with a preliminary and final plat for Unit 4, Lot 12, and a final plan for Unit 4, Lot 12. What this does is it delivers a buildable lot so that the developer can meet the development timeline they set out, which is pretty aggressive, to start moving dirt at their own risk in August of 2015 and to deliver the building in August of 2016. And you'll see in the agreement that the Plan Commission has passed on to you that we're delivering the plat with this action, and then it gives administrative approval to staff to do some of the final details. There isn't much room for variance. It's a big lot, it's a big building on a big lot, and the building will be in substantial conformation to the existing building, so we'd be looking at basic site design, such as parking lot lighting standards, landscaping, and the facade, but it's going to look like the building that's already there. And the Plan Commission was comfortable passing that final stamp on to the administrative review. And then the part two that I reference is that no future development will go forward in the park until we re-agree on the development agreement. So we've got to make an amendment to the original development agreement from 2004. Because we were moving a roadway, we're changing some of the lot design, and we just want to look at it one more time, do some traffic work, make sure everything flows right. And so the developer is aware of this, and we'll be bringing back, they've already begun the final engineering again, and they'll be bringing that back relatively quickly to the Planning and Zoning Commission. So that's what I have. So what you would be doing tonight, the vote that you would make, is to deliver Lot 12 with administrative approval of the final site plan, knowing that the second steps are coming forward after this.
Okay. Is there a discussion? Alderperson O'Leary?
Since the second part is coming later, I see here we want to waive the, we're going to waive second reading, even though we don't get the second part?
They would appreciate that you waive second reading because they want to start moving the dirt within a few weeks. Yeah.
Okay. All right, thank you.
And it is just there, the buildable lot. You're moving the lot lines on the plat at this point.
Okay.
Is there further discussion? Hearing none, I'll ask for a roll call then.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Finucane?
Yes.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Adai?
Okay. And for the developers' request, is there a
I'll make a motion to waive second reading and approve on second reading.
Second.
It's been moved by Alderman Snow and seconded by Alderman Jacobson. Discussion? Roll call.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Finucane?
Yes.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Adai?
Thank you. Motion carried. I'd like to thank council for your support of this investment in our community. I'd like to thank developer Good. And who's with you this evening, Mark?
Go Mom, he's our civil engineer for the park.
Thank you. Well, thank you for the cooperation on this project, and we'll move forward.
Thank you.
Yes. Resolution 2015-92, adopting certain financial management policies. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Alderperson Noriko. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Alderperson O'Leary. I'll turn to Kathy Haley with a motion on the floor.
I heard it. Okay, last budget season we adopted financial policies during the budget process with the intention of reviewing those annually during every budget season. We have done so with the current policies and came up with four recommended changes to the existing policies. The first change is to the investment policy, really more of a house cleaning, changing comptroller treasurer to a finance director. We updated the collaterals. We upped it to 110% of uninsured amount. It was at 105%. And then the reporting section of that is in line with current practice. The other three policy changes go hand in hand with our best practice process that we had going on during the budget. They were recommendations from our audit team. The first one for the accounting, auditing, and financial reporting really relates to journal entries. Past practice has had the audit team doing several journal entries while they're on site for the audit. Staff is going to be taking that on. That's really should be staff's responsibility. This kind of tightens up the internal control process while we take that in-house, and then the auditors can do the auditing. So that's the first one. The second one is for the budget process and budget amendments, just kind of, again, tightening up that internal control process. This is practice. This is my practice, how we do these. The city doesn't do a lot of budget amendments, but I think it's always good to have this documented as the approval process. And then finally, the capital asset policy change is, again, past practice has been that the audit team has tracked and recorded our fixed assets at the end of the year. Staff is going to be taking that in-house as well with the implementation of these internal controls. It also
factors in any grant tracking. So if we are using federal funds for some of these capital purchases, it's very specific if you read it on how those should be tracked and reported. So those are the changes.
Okay. Director Haley, thank you for bringing these internal controls forward. I would just ask, with staff assuming these different roles, I assume these are saving taxpayers money in the annual audit?
Correct.
Is that correct?
That is the intention, yes.
Thank you. Other discussion from council? I'll ask with a resolution, do we need a roll call?
Please.
Roll call, please.
Finucane?
Yes.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Adai?
Thank you. Motion carried. Ordinance 2015-34, amending Chapter 54, Financial Administration, as it pertains to adopting a purchasing manual and financial policies. And this is before us at first reading. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Alderman Snow. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Alderperson Noriko. I'll turn to Director Haley.
So this is, ordinance is being brought forward to you tonight to kind of sync in with the passing of the new purchasing manual, which will be on the August 10th meeting. The second reading of this would be August 10th as well. It's, again, in accordance with best governance practices and a desire for greater transparency. It is recommended to adopt financial policies and a comprehensive purchasing manual. Updates to Chapter 54 have been prepared, which would eliminate duplication of language or conflict between Chapter 54 and those updated policies. I think it's important to note that staff is responsible for complying with the policy and the manual, and any changes to either need the approval of City Council. There is one recommended change that is just a change to Chapter 54 in regard to budget amendments. The current language is a bit muddled, and the way it's worded, if taken verbatim, would allow staff to go over in a fund budget-wise, which really is against audit regulations, and would we would get a management note on that. So we've rewritten that to, I think, make more sense, to go with current practice, to just make it easier to know when a budget amendment is required. So.
Is there discussion, questions of Director Haley? I'll ask for a roll call.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Finucane?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Adai?
Motion carried. Resolution 2015-93, authorizing the negotiation and execution of an amendment to the consulting services agreement with SafeBuilt. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Moved by Alderperson Noriko. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Alderman Marquardt?
Finucane.
Finucane, I'm sorry. Discussion. I'll turn to
I can start, and
City Attorney
and the Community Development Director can take over.
Thank you.
Now, nearly a year and a half ago, the city entered into a professional services agreement with SafeBuilt, wherein they've been providing building inspection services to the city. The basis of the majority of those services relating to building plan review, is provided to the city on a percentage of fee basis, wherein the city charges those who are building within the city a building permit fee, and a percentage of that fee is paid to SafeBuilt, and within that percentage, they perform all of the services they provide. So they perform their plan review, all of the required inspections, documentation of the reports back to the city on the status of the project. It has been the city's intention since the outset of that agreement to go through a RFP process and allow the City Council to select who you wish to have as your vendor for a specified period of time providing these building inspection services. SafeBuilt has has provided those services admirably. They stepped up when the city had a need for them. We anticipate they will be one of the parties that proposes, but there may be other parties as well. Because they perform work on a percentage of fee basis, if there's a new construction project that starts tomorrow and we receive the building permit fees for that, the inspections associated with that project may carry forward over 6 months or a year. And if the city council ended up selecting an alternate provider of services, if we pay a percentage of fee today and not all the inspections are completed during Safebuilt's tenure, we may have inspections down the road the city would have to pay for without having revenue available to pay for that. So we've discussed that issue with Safebuilt, and the proposal that's before you would allow us to convert from the percentage model we're working on now temporarily to an hourly-based model where we pay for services as they occur. That gives us the ability to close out permits that we're currently working on with Safebuilt and to start projects, new projects that are important to the city to allow development to continue going forward without committing ourselves necessarily to one vendor. So it puts the council in a position where you can go through the RFP process and make an informed selection on who your vendor will be. Safebuilt has been very cooperative to work with throughout this process, and they recognize the council's commitment to going through the RFP. They were very forthright and forthcoming in providing this as an option to get us through this transition period. And the recommendation would be to allow us to go forward with this amendment, again, so that the city isn't bound to one contractor to complete projects going forward.
I just want to add two things. First off, we have in the audience with us Steve Toulumis is our building official. He's our chief building official. He oversees the work of Dan Burrows and Jeff Weiss when they're here. And with him is Steve Nero, who is the business development agent for Safebuilt. And then I, as Anne-Marie knows, I will always point out when I've made a mistake. I made one in this memo. The very first sentence, I took over oversight of the department in May of 2015. So I used the wrong date there. Safebuilt began in March of 2014. We modified the contract in September of 2014, by the way, for the extra code enforcement. So I apologize if there was any confusion on the date.
Ellen, when would the, and I assume you're the person to direct this to, when would the RFP be anticipated on the street?
I've finished my second draft of it. I'm still collecting some numbers. I was waiting for some numbers from Safebuilt that I got last week in reference to the number of inspections and the man hours, because they were tracked in their system and not in our own system. So within the next meeting or so, you'll see it. It'll be relatively quick.
Thank you.
Okay.
Other discussion, Alderman Snow?
For our RFP, when we go out and hire a company, whoever that is, I assume it's going to be for a certain length of time. And I don't know if that's going to be on a percentage of permit fee again or hourly, but I guess they're probably suggesting there needs to be something in there so when that term ends and we potentially hire a different company, that we still have the ability to do that shifting.
Mm-hmm.
So I assume that potential problem would be taken care of somehow.
You know, I talked with Matt Royer from Denver, from Safebuilt, for over 2 hours as we worked through this, and he said that in every city they've been in, they end up coming back and retooling. For example, Safebuilt's doing the work in Glenview, Winnetka, Wilmette, and Evanston, and they had started there on an hourly and then went to percentage.
Right.
And it's just based on the workload.
Yeah, I agree with doing it this time. I just, you know, maybe in 5-6 years, though, if we shift companies again or something, whenever that might be, I guess I'd want to make sure the contract has that clause in there of the ability to renegotiate that method, whichever method we choose.
Agreed.
Yeah. Other discussion? Seeing none, Alderman Jacobson.
Obviously, we discussed when the department was outsourced that it was done at a cost savings of the city. Have we done any analysis now of what it will cost us, obviously now hourly, versus what it was costing us for full-time employees?
Yeah, Director Haley looked extensively into that in the last few weeks. I think the savings are over $80,000 so far, but as development's picking up, we're going to be needing more services. One of the things I'm finding is we don't have enough outsourced services downstairs right now. It's a struggle some days to even answer the phone, quite honestly, with two people answering. So Dan Burrows, as I wrote in the memo, who's our deputy building official, stepped up and has been helping Brenda. And then we have hired a part-time administrative assistant in the community development. This was a position that was transferred from the city manager's office to our department, so it was not a new hire. It was a position already on the books. And Natalie Nelson has started this week, and she is actually going to be backing up Brenda a little bit downstairs.
I mean, that was the benefit that we were sold on in going to a percentage model, was that they would scale up as need be based on the need. And now we're saying we're going to go back to an hourly. If we have so much more need, isn't that going to cost us significantly more?
The hourly is just for this interim period, and recognize that the 3M permit will be somewhere over $200,000. And so to have given 75% of that was a significant amount of money. And that's why we're making the recommendation to go to the hourly right now in the interim, so that whoever takes the contract after we've done the RFP process and reviewed all the qualified vendors, we'll have enough money left and still within our control to pay for the services.
Does
that make sense?
To your point, Alderman Jacobson, as we go through the RFP process, we're going to try and give the council kind of competitive cost pricing structures and identify what the best structures are, but preserving that scalability where as demand goes up, we provide extra services without incurring unnecessary costs for the city. As demand reduces, we cut our services and don't have a flat level that we have to maintain.
And just to build on what Attorney Frieders just said, we'll be happy to include further analysis when we bring the RFP to you at the August 10th or the subsequent meeting, so that you can see the cost savings this has saved the city in switching to contracting out. So we'll show that to you.
Thank you. Other discussion or questions? Seeing none, I'll ask for a roll call.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
No.
Finucane?
Yes.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
7-I.
Thank you. Motion carried.
Mayor? May I please? Yes. I just want to make one comment for the community that's watching this at home, since they may not read the packet. But there was an interesting spreadsheet in here that actually contains some interesting news, I thought, at least, because I'm a building department geek. But the valuation of the permits from fiscal year 2015 over 2014 was up 500%. So we're seeing less permits, but we're seeing permits of larger value, which shows people are starting to invest in the community. And so we're real pleased to see that.
Thank you for that highlight, Director DeVita. Moving to award of a bid in the amount of $265,169 for the Kishwaukee Drive Manor Lane Water Main Project to H. Linden and Sons, with staff authority to approve change orders up to $280,000. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Alderperson Noriko. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Alderman Marquardt. City Engineer Laskowski.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. If you feel like this project snuck up on you, it's because it probably snuck up on all of us, but it's a really great deal. What happened was we've been experiencing a lot of water main breaks on Kishwaukee Lane and Manor Drive. So many that the last time we responded to a fire call down on Kishwaukee Lane, the main blew up in four different places. So while we were investigating the water main breaks, we found that the township and the county were working together to repave this road, which provided us with a very good opportunity to get in there and replace our water main at the time. By doing that, it's going to end up saving us about $28,000, probably more, on the cost of replacing the pavement. As the county and township are working together to repave the entire road, the curb and gutter, and the sidewalks. So to put it in perspective, the one resident, we have maps of where all the different breaks occur throughout town. And there was one poor resident in town who had 8 main breaks in front of his house over the time that we've tracked on this on Kishwaukee Lane. So this is a really good project to address the poor water main at this time. And when you look at the background, the staff report, you'll see that I broke up the bid into a base bid and an alternate bid. And the reason I did that was because the engineer's estimate came in over what our budget was. So I was anticipating that that the project was going to cost $326,000. We ended up getting a good bid at $265,000. And the reason my estimate was high is because I usually base my prices off the previous project that we had. So if you do look at the table that's in the staff report, you'll see that my number's at 326, Elliott and Wood's at 322. So I'm only $4,000 off of what I thought the lowest bid would be, being that Elliott and Wood's working on our South First Street project. So the alternate bid provided us the opportunity, should prices come in higher, to address that segment of Main just in front of the three houses where we've had 14 water main breaks in the past. However, prices came in good. So the thing is, we're gonna be able to replace 1,373 linear feet of water main at $265,000 and not have to do the pavement replacement ourselves. So that being said, the lowest bid came in from H. Linden and Sons. They've done work in town before. Brian Favor is here from the water department, has supervised their work in the past, and it's been a quality that's good enough for the city to accept. So I would recommend awarding the bid to H. Linden and Sons at this time.
And this, I would just note to council that this project really speaks to that intergovernmental collaboration that we spoke of earlier this evening in the state of the city. So it's good to build those relationships and have those relationships in place. Other discussion? Seeing none, I'm sorry,
I just have a question. When did the county approach the city and say, you know, we just want to notify you, we're doing this work, and you recognize that this was a problem location?
This time it didn't quite happen in that manner, but we did end up crossing paths at the point where we found out that it would work out really well. So there is an organization called DSATS where the township and county participate regularly. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be a forum where we have the opportunity to indicate to each other what we're doing in the upcoming year, so that if there's a benefit that the city would be able to provide the county or vice versa, we can jump on that opportunity.
Okay, so there will be an established medium of discussion so that it won't just be, you know, somebody tripping over someone else or something.
No, exactly, okay. Yeah.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Other discussion? Alderperson O'Leary.
I just wanted to know, and I'm looking at all the bids that had come in, and I was wondering, did our local people get a chance to had that extra?
They did.
Percentage they did? Okay.
The local bidder's preference is 5%. Elliott and Wood would have been the local preference, and they were above that 5% threshold at this time.
All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Other discussion? Seeing none, I'll ask for a roll call.
Noriko?
Yes.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Finucane?
Yes.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
Adai?
Thank you. Motion carried. Request for a proposal for construction engineering services for the Kishwaukee Lane Manor Drive water main replacement, not to exceed $20,000. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Moved by Alderman Marquardt. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Alderperson Noriko. Discussion. City engineer.
This is associated with the previous item. It's going to be the engineering services associated with monitoring the construction on the project. So as I indicated, this was a project that materialized fairly quickly, so we aren't going to have our civil engineering intern on staff to monitor the project, and the resources of the city engineer and the project implementation engineer are such that they're not going to be able to monitor the project as often as need be. So in this case, we'd be recommending putting out an RFP for construction engineering services. It would be based on a request for qualifications that we brought forth in February 27th. We have identified four firms that we're going to contact if approved tonight, distribute that RFP, perform interviews very quickly this week, probably over the phone, and then identify who we think is a top candidate, negotiate the contract with them to make sure that the engineering services come under $20,000 threshold, and then proceed from there, hopefully the following week, beginning the project.
Alderperson Noriko.
Under ordinary circumstances, when you weren't wearing two hats as both city engineer and interim public works director, would this work have fallen under your office?
This would have been work that our office could have performed. Generally, the services have been performed, have been outsourced, even in times when it wasn't a tight timeline, just because the duties right now of the office don't have the capacity to accommodate a construction project in the field on a daily basis.
Okay. So this kind of request is not reflective of additional duties on your part or anything?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Other discussion, questions? Alderperson O'Leary.
Okay, so you're going to send out RFPs for this project, and then you're going to pick, but it will not come back to us?
On this one, no. We wouldn't come back to the city council on this one because we were anticipating that the cost is going to be under $20,000, but we're also seeking your approval to recognize that staff will negotiate the best price with these professional engineering services.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Other discussion? Seeing none, I'll ask for a roll call.
Baker?
Yes.
O'Leary?
Yes.
Jacobson?
Yes.
Finucane?
Yes.
Marquardt?
Yes.
Snow?
Yes.
Noriko?
Yes.
Ray?
Yes.
8-I.
Thank you. Motion carried. That concludes our business for this evening. I'll move to communications. Call on Alderman Jacobson.
No report.
Alderman Finucane?
No report.
Alderman Marquardt?
No report.
Alderman Snow?
No report.
Alderperson Noriko?
I just wanted to comment on the community conversations. I've been to several of them and have been impressed by the number of citizens and participants at those conversations. I think they have been well structured because it seemed like the discussion level was very high. People came out talking about their conversations, and so I think the participants were really invested, and I think that speaks well for the continuation and the ultimate success in the strategic plan process. So thank you to staff for working hard at that, and I'm looking forward to seeing the results.
Thank you. Alderman Baker.
No report.
Alderperson O'Leary?
No report.
Okay. City Manager Gordon.
I just want to add what Alderwoman Noriko just said, that the next community conversation and the final community conversation will be Thursday evening. So that's on the schedule that has been publicized. So please, if you haven't had an opportunity to participate, please come to Thursday evening.
Is there a Hispanic version?
Yes, that one. Yes, that is taking place Wednesday night.
Wednesday night at Conexión Comunidad.
Yes.
And will be conducted in all Spanish.
That is correct.
Thank you. And Thursday, the 30th, is at River Heights.
That is correct.
O'clock.
Yep.
Thank you. City Attorney.
No report.
City Clerk.
No report.
Chief Lowry.
No report.
Director Haley.
No report.
Chief Hicks. Director DeVita.
No report.
City Engineer.
No report.
Okay. With that, I'm told we don't need the executive session, so at this point, I would entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
It's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Moved by Jacobson. Alderman Jacobson. Seconded by Alderman Markwart. All those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
You're getting a little something when I ask you, you know?
Thank you.
I'm going to be here for a while anyway.